Hi guys, welcome back. Today we are going to discuss emergency drugs required in dental practice. This is a very important topic for practical exam as well as for viva, and also every dental clinic must have an emergency drugs kit. And apart from that, knowledge of how and when to use them, what doses to administer, is very important, so one should keep reviewing this so that if a medical emergency does occur, we don't waste time in recalling things. Before we start, please hit the subscribe button, and now let's get started. So the first one here is oxygen. When there is a medical emergency in which there is hypoxemia, oxygen is important. So when this happens, we need to give supplemental oxygen. Now, why is oxygen important in a medical emergency? You see, when there is hypoxemia, it leads to anaerobic metabolism and metabolic acidosis. And when this happens, it decreases the efficacy of pharmacological intervention in emergencies. Means whatever drugs we administer to take care of the medical emergency, like for example, epinephrine, it will not be as effective if you don't take care of the hypoxia. But remember that oxygen can be given in any medical emergency except hyperventilation. In hyperventilation, oxygen is not given. Now, how is oxygen given? If the patient can spontaneously breathe, then we can use a full face mask. And if the patient has apnea, which means he cannot breathe on his own, then bag wall mask device has to be used. Usually the source of this oxygen is a portable e-cylinder which can hold 600 liters of oxygen. This is enough till the patient can be shifted to a hospital setting. The single most important drug in the injectable emergency drugs list is epinephrine. It's a sympathomimetic drug and it acts on the alpha and beta adrenergic receptors. So what happens when we inject epinephrine? The primary effects include bronchodilation, vasoconstriction, increased heart rate, and contractility of the heart. There is increased cerebral blood flow and stabilization of mast cells. You know the cells involved in allergic reaction, these are the mast cells. Because of these effects, epinephrine is useful when there is severe bronchospasm because it dilates the bronchi, and it's useful in cardiac arrest because it increases the heart rate and contractility, and as it stabilizes mast cells, it's effective in anaphylaxis. So that's why epinephrine is the drug of choice for the emergency treatment of anaphylaxis and asthma, which does not respond to its drug of first choice. In asthma, the drug of first choice is salbutamol or albuterol. Both of these are same, and both of these are bronchodilators. But if the asthma is not responding to these drugs, then epinephrine is the second drug of choice. So how to administer this drug? It's available in auto-injector or preloaded syringes. Preloaded syringes save our time when there is an emergency. An example of auto-injector system is EpiPen. This is a self-injector device. This is usually given to patients who already know that they have an allergy to something, and when they are more prone to anaphylaxis. It's also available in ampoules. It's available in two formulations, 1:1000 and 1:10,000. 1:1000 means 1 mg per ml, and 1:10,000 means 1 mg per 10 ml. After giving epinephrine, the dose has to be repeated in 5 minutes until resolution of the event or until the ambulance arrives. 1:1000 is for intramuscular, subcutaneous and sublingual use. For adults, the dosage is 0.3 mg and for children, it is 0.15 mg. 1:10,000 is for intravenous use. So when do we require the IV form? If there is cardiac arrest, the dose is 1 mg intravenously, because in cardiac arrest, intramuscular injection is not given. Remember this, because this will not have a significant effect. So for cardiac arrest, the route of administration is intravenous. Ephedrine is another drug which has similar cardiovascular actions like epinephrine, but it is less potent and it has a prolonged duration of action. And epinephrine has a short duration of action. So remember these differences. And what you need to remember about ephedrine is that it is useful in case of moderate to severe hypotension. For severe hypotension, the dose is 5 mg intravenously or 10 to 25 mg intramuscularly. Next drug in our list is nitroglycerine. This is indicated for acute angina or myocardial infarction. Why? Because angina occurs when the heart is not getting as much blood as it needs, as one or more of the arteries of the heart are constricted or narrowed. And nitroglycerine is a vasodilator, which means it dilates those arteries. So if the patient complains of acute chest pain and he has a history of angina, then this is the drug we need to administer. For emergencies like these, nitroglycerine is available as sublingual tablets or sublingual spray. The recommended dose for nitroglycerine tablets is 0.4 mg and this is given sublingually. The sublingual spray can be used every 5 minutes up to 3 doses, which means that if the pain of angina is not relieved in one dose, within 1 to 2 minutes, then you can repeat this dose 2 to 3 times, but there should be a gap of 5 minutes between the doses. The spray is better than the tablet form because it has a very short shelf life. So if the patient has his own tablets, in case of an emergency, it is best not to use them as they can be inactive. So we should use the tablets available in the clinic or we can use the spray. The spray has a longer shelf life also. Common side effects of nitroglycerine are headaches, dizziness, and flushing. Next is aromatic ammonia. This is a respiratory stimulant. One of the commonly seen medical emergencies in the dental office is syncope. In this case, apart from keeping the patient in Trendelenburg position and giving oxygen, we can use aromatic ammonia. So you have to crack it or crush it and hold it 4 to 6 inches under the patient's nose. This has a very bad odor which stimulates the respiratory and vasomotor centers in the medulla. The next life-saving drug is aspirin. It has been shown to reduce mortality from acute myocardial infarction, which is commonly known as heart attack. It's very important to understand the difference between angina and myocardial infarction. Angina is when the arteries supplying the blood to the heart are narrowed, and in myocardial infarction, there is irreversible damage to the heart muscle, which is getting no blood supply. So there is necrosis of that part of the heart muscle. So angina is like a warning signal that the heart is getting less blood supply. So this is the theory. But when the patient is right in front of you, how are you going to know whether the patient is having chest pain due to angina or it is because of heart attack? It is very difficult to distinguish. The patients experiencing angina usually have intermittent pressure or an ache beneath the sternum, that is the breast bone. They feel a squeezing sensation in the chest and they can also have pain in the shoulder, arm, back, neck or jaw. With a heart attack, the pain is usually in the middle of the chest that may spread to the back, jaw or left arm. It can also happen that the pain is in one or more of these places, that is the back, jaw or left arm, and not in the chest at all. So the pain of a heart attack is similar to the pain of angina, but it is generally more severe. It lasts longer and it is not relieved by rest or nitroglycerine. So if you have already given nitroglycerine and it is not effective, then that means the patient is having a heart attack or acute myocardial infarction, and then you should treat that. Another thing you should ask the patient is if he has had anginal chest pain before. If he has, it is very likely that the current pain is because of angina. If this is the first time the patient is experiencing this kind of pain, then we should treat it as if it were acute myocardial infarction. Another differentiating point is that If the patient's blood pressure is elevated during the episode of chest pain, angina pectoris is the most likely cause. And if the blood pressure falls below the patient's baseline value or immediate preoperative value, then it is acute myocardial infarction. So if there is acute myocardial infarction, this is when aspirin comes to the rescue. Aspirin is an antiplatelet drug or an anticoagulant. So what it does is it prevents further clot formation. So it stops the progression of acute myocardial infarction. Patients should be given 325 mg aspirin tablet to chew for 30 seconds and then they should swallow it. For pediatric patients, the dose is 10 to 15 mg per kilogram. Aspirin is contraindicated in asthma, bleeding disorders, and in known hypersensitivity to aspirin. In such a patient, the lowest effective dose is not known with certainty, but we should give a minimum of 162 mg immediately to any patient with pain that indicates acute myocardial infarction. For the management of severe pain of myocardial infarction, we can give morphine. The dose has to be titrated in 1 to 3 mg increments intravenously or 5 mg increments intramuscularly until there is relief of pain. In older patients, we should give lower doses. If morphine is not available, nitrous oxide is the second choice to manage pain from a myocardial infarction. It should be administered with oxygen in a concentration approximating 35%, or it should be titrated to effect. Glucose preparations are used to treat hypoglycemia, but if the patient is unconscious, we should never administer oral drugs because the risk of aspiration is there. In this case, we should obtain IV access and administer dextrose 50% in water. 50 to 100 ml of this should be given. Glucagon is another drug for hypoglycemia in an unconscious patient and it can be given intramuscularly, so you don't have to obtain IV access and it acts within 10 minutes after administration. Adult dosage for glucagon is 1 mg and pediatric dose is 0.5 mg. Next is albuterol, also known as salbutamol. This is a bronchodilator. So this is the first choice for bronchospasm, which can happen because of asthma. It is given via an inhaler and it has a peak effect in 30 to 60 minutes with a duration of action of 4 to 6 hours. Adult dose is 2 to 3 sprays every 1 to 2 minutes up to 3 times. And for pediatric use, it is 1 spray every 1 to 2 minutes up to 3 times. Antihistamines. These are used in allergic reaction. There are two routes for this. One is oral and another is parenteral. If the patient only has a mild allergic reaction which is not life-threatening, then we can consider the oral route. Parenteral administration is required for life-threatening reactions. Two antihistamines are important, that is diphenhydramine and chlorpheniramine. Dosage is diphenhydramine 25 to 50 mg or chlorpheniramine, which is also known as Avil, 10 to 20 mg. This can be administered by oral or parenteral route. Then there are anticholinergic drugs. The three primary anticholinergic medications are atropine, glycopyrrolate, and scopolamine. These medications are useful in the management of hypotension. Atropine has the fastest onset time, so this drug is indicated for the management of hypotension, which is accompanied by bradycardia, which means heart rate less than 60 beats per minute. The dose recommended is 0.5 mg intravenously initially, and it is followed by increments as necessary, but the maximum dose that can be given is 0.04 mg per kg. Dose of less than 0.4 mg has been shown to cause bradycardia. So atropine can treat bradycardia, but it can also cause bradycardia. So you can understand how important it is to use the right dose. So we saw that atropine is for hypotension with bradycardia. Now, if the patient has hypotension with tachycardia or hypotension with normal heart rate, then phenylephrine is the drug of choice. It has a fast onset and short duration of action of 5 to 10 minutes. A total of 100 milligrams should be administered every 10 to 15 minutes for the hypotension. How does it act? You see, phenylephrine is a selective alpha-1 agonist. So it results in peripheral vasoconstriction causing increased blood pressure. If a dentist administers opioids or benzodiazepines to induce moderate or deep sedation, they must include reversal agents in the emergency kit. For example, naloxone is a specific opioid antagonist that reverses opioid-induced respiratory depression. Fentanyl is an opioid analgesic which is used in IV sedations in the dental office. If overdose occurs, respiratory depression and over-sedation can occur. In such a case, naloxone is an opioid antagonist that will reverse all of the effects of fentanyl or any other opioid. The dose is 0.4 mg to 2 mg intravenously, and it can be titrated in increments of 0.1 mg. Benzodiazepines are also used in most IV sedations. So if benzodiazepine was administered to the patient, it can have side effects like respiratory depression. In that case, Flumazenil is used. Flumazenil is a specific benzodiazepine antagonist that reverses sedation and respiratory depression resulting from benzodiazepine administration. The dose is 0.1 to 0.2 mg intravenously, given in increments with a maximum dose of 1 mg. Speaking of benzodiazepines, benzodiazepine is administered to manage prolonged or recurrent seizures, that is status epilepticus. For all types of seizures, intravenous diazepam 5 to 10 mg can be given. It has a rapid onset of action. Now, although diazepam has a rapid onset of action, when the patient is having a seizure, it is obviously very difficult for a dentist to place an IV line, right? Because it is not something we do every day. So drugs which can be given intramuscularly like lorazepam has been reported as the drug of choice for status epilepticus. Midazolam is another alternative which can be given intramuscularly. Adult dose for lorazepam is 4 mg intramuscular and for midazolam 5 to 10 mg intramuscular. A repeat dose can be given if it is necessary for a normally breathing patient. Patients should be monitored carefully after administration since respiratory depression and sedation are the side effects of these drugs, as we just saw, which can be reversed by reversal agents. Apart from having all the medications, there are a few important points to consider. These emergency drugs and oxygen should be placed in an area that is readily accessible in the event of an emergency. Staff members in the dental clinic should also be trained on what their role is during a medical emergency. One should check the expiration dates of all the drugs and the level of the oxygen tanks at least annually. One should have protocols in place on what procedure to follow based on the nature of the emergency. The dental clinic should have the telephone numbers of the nearest emergency services or ambulance. Patient emergencies can occur in the clinic's waiting area also. So you should have airway equipment that is portable rather than fixed to a room. So that's it for today. I know this topic is a bit boring, but think about it. You can save somebody's life if you study this properly. If you're interested in more oral surgery videos, you can check out the playlist here. And I'll see you very soon. Bye.